Hello, and welcome to our series on primary prevention of coronary artery disease. Today we'll be discussing the management of hypertriglyceridemia. Today's key takeaways are to understand key recommendations from the 2021 ACC Expert Consensus Update in the management of hypertriglyceridemia. We'll learn about the efficacy of lifestyle interventions for hypertriglyceridemia, and we'll learn about drug therapy options for hypertriglyceridemia and some of the data behind them. Treatment is divided into four risk groups. The first is those with established atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, that is, a secondary prevention context. We'll be discussing those in the primary prevention context, those with diabetes, those with severe hypertriglyceridemia, and high-risk primary prevention patients. Hypertriglyceridemia can be divided into those with mild to moderate HTG and severe HTG. Mild to moderate includes those with levels between 150 and 500 milligrams per deciliter, and severe includes individuals with levels greater than 500 milligrams per deciliter, and those at especially high risk who have levels greater than 1,000 milligrams per deciliter. The first thing that we should do when we diagnose hypertriglyceridemia is evaluate for secondary causes of the disease. Patients with HTG are often multimorbid, and uncontrolled medical syndromes, some prescription drugs, and lifestyle risk factors can all increase triglyceride levels. Special attention should be paid to those with nephrotic syndrome, CKD, rheumatologic disease, or Cushing syndrome, as well as those who are prescribed steroids, immunosuppressants, HIV proteasome inhibitors, or certain oncologic meds. When we move to the clinical management, there are two prongs to this: lifestyle intervention and drug therapy. Now, while HTG can be caused by poor lifestyle habits, it's also exceptionally responsive to lifestyle interventions. Weight loss is considered to be most effective, with just a 5 to 10% body weight loss reduction being associated with a 20% reduction in triglycerides. Triglycerides may also be lowered by up to 50 to 70% by weight loss alone. Dietary patterns are also very powerful. In the guidelines, dietary patterns lower in carbohydrates, higher in proteins, and higher in healthy fats like monounsaturated and polyunsaturated fatty acids are recommended. And increasing physical activity and reducing sedentary time can also have a profound impact on triglyceride levels. When we look at drug therapy, we first think about treating the greatest immediate risk. So in those with ASCVD, we think about statin therapy and achieving our LDL treatment goals. In those with diabetes, we think about managing their blood glucose levels. In those with severe hypertriglyceridemia, we have to initiate statins and lifestyle interventions to reduce pancreatitis risk. And in those with mild to moderate HTG, we have to begin with education and lifestyle modification. When we think about the armamentarium of drugs we can use to treat hypertriglyceridemia, we think about statins first and foremost, which lower triglycerides by 10 to 20%. PCSK9 inhibitors that lower triglycerides by 25% approximately. Ezetimibe, which does lower risk, but primarily through an LDL mechanism. Icosapent ethyl, which is the only FDA-approved and recommended treatment specific for triglycerides, which can lower levels by up to 40%. Fibrates, which can lower levels by up to 50%, but there's currently mixed data about cardiovascular outcomes in the modern era. And bile acid sequestrants like cholestyramine, which can paradoxically raise triglyceride levels. After we've addressed treating the underlying medical comorbidities, we may consider using triglyceride-specific therapy in selected populations. In the US, this primarily means using icosapent ethyl. For those who have severe hypertriglyceridemia, that is, levels above 500, it is recommended that you initiate icosapent ethyl if that has not been brought down with lifestyle interventions and a statin. For those with ASCVD, after LDL-specific therapies, you may consider icosapent ethyl. And for those with diabetes who have persistent hypertriglyceridemia after glucose-directed therapies, you may consider icosapent ethyl. There's no current indication for those who have mild to moderate hypertriglyceridemia to be treated with icosapent ethyl, but you can intensify statin therapy at this point. The 2021 Expert Consensus Update was primarily authored in order to update us on the use of omega-3 fatty acids, such as icosapent ethyl. Looking at a host of trials that were published between 2018 and 2020, the ASCEND trial, VITAL trial, OMEMI trial, and STRENGTH trial, a mixture of EPA and DHA failed to reduce the combined endpoints of cardiovascular disease. However, A very important trial in this space was the REDUCE trial that studied icosapent ethyl, a purified form of EPA. They studied it in a secondary prevention and high-risk primary prevention setting and looked at the effect on MACE across 4.9 years. They found that there was a 25% reduction in the composite primary endpoint, a 26% reduction in the composite secondary endpoint of CV death, non-fatal MI, or stroke, and a 20% reduction in cardiovascular death. It was this trial that really led to the recommendation of the use of icosapent ethyl in the guidelines. I should also mention dietary supplements. About 8% of Americans take dietary supplements, and there are numerous omega-3 fatty acid supplements on the market. These are not over-the-counter drugs. These are supplements that are not regulated. They are often contaminated with saturated fats, oxidized fatty acids, and they are not clinical grade. Thus, dietary supplementation of omega-3 fatty acids is not recommended. And then if we return to our drug therapy schema, we see that for those with persistent elevations, we can consider combination therapy. So in summary, triglyceride-rich lipoproteins are in the causal pathway for ASCVD and are associated with risk. Lifestyle interventions, including weight loss, diet, and exercise, are first line for all patients with hypertriglyceridemia. All patients with HTG should be assessed for secondary causes leading to elevation, as well as other medical comorbidities that need to be treated, like CAD, type 2 diabetes, obesity, and others. And after LDL-directed therapies, icosapent ethyl is the only adjunctive therapy recommended in the US guidelines, and it's reserved for high-risk patients. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope you found this video educational.